take on them. Rarison.
I have sat on the nuclear throne. I have heard its crumbly stones topple down as the velvet carpet laid on its steps descended below my feet with their own ascension. The blood-ordained parts of my body, weary of melee and duel, lay rest on cold stone and metal as it becomes mixed with the blood and the blood of others, marking it as mine. Turning around, I see bullet casings, Club Penguin, and my copy of Wheel of Time. But beyond all that, both over the horizon so incomprehensibly far away, yet irradiating enough to fill said horizon, glancing my eyelashes enough to make said eyes flutter, but not close, I see the heat death of the universe, the abyss of the sun, so blindingly bright, as dark as the most swallowing deep, the eyes that stare back at me, the guts of said abyss, line my past and the nuclear throne. Nuclear Throne was released in 2013 to early access on Steam, developed by Vlambeer off of their game jam production Wasteland Kings, fully published in 2015. It follows a band of mutants in an apocalyptic setting. It's not post-apocalyptic. Your goal is to reach the titular Nuclear Throne, kinda. It's hard. It has many weapons, some familiar, some strange. It has many enemies, some familiar, some strange. You die very quickly. You kill very quickly. You level up by collecting radiation and obtaining new mutations. You become Death, the Destroyer of Worlds. It's a top-down shooter. It's a roguelike. It's a roguelite. It's a roguelike-like. It's Wheelbite on a tray flip you ride away from. It's a frontside crook that pinches. It's Jerry Sue's Stay Gold part from America. It's Kurt Angle winning Olympic gold with a broken neck. It's an IKEA bag full of sledgehammers. In Nuclear Throne, you can swing a sledgehammer to kill and knock an enemy into another enemy, killing them. With the complementing upgrade increasing fly distance, I am taken back to pinball arcades of before, as bodies become missile-like balls bouncing back and forth, alternating from inanimate object to soon inanimate object, all complemented by the cacophony of bending steel and mutant cry. Almost similar to the blaring high score related noises and bright lights of the former. There is a clear intent of continuing the arcade theme and display of arcade philosophy in Nuclear Throne. The title screen, hypnotic, almost sucking you in. Character select screen, equally as energy-filled as the gameplay, but also maintains that almost melancholic sadness and futility that is underlying throughout a Nuclear Throne. Another shared characteristic with arcades is its difficulty, which is normally balanced out by arcades through enjoyment, half being the social aspect, and the other half being the physical interaction with the cabinets. Translating this into the common controllers of the solitary home, and the fact that you do not need to pay for each run or to continue, much detail and visceral thought was put into the satisfying aspects of playing Nuclear Throne at home. Incredibly crisp weapon noises, each uniquely mechanical or brutal, unique in their own rhythm and reaction the game shows the player. Be it the aforementioned flight of the bandits, screen shake almost thrashing the camera as bullets expunge themselves like frosting out of a pastry bag, and dense tight corridors that light up with a muzzle flash and energy beams. Aiming and movement is so incredibly tight in Nuclear Throne that it's elementary, translating what I want to do and what my character does. Like I'm playing some VR experience of Step Up Revolution. Masahiro Sakurai, creator of Kirby and the Super Smash Bros. Series, recently on his YouTube channel talked about the importance of seemingly small details such as screen shake and freeze frame.
これがあるのとないのとでは手応えが全然違ってきてしまうので結構大事ですね。
Sakurai talks of how a simple design feature such as this both give clear information to the player that an action occurred, but also gives that moment enough time to be highlighted in such a way and enjoyed by the player much more. And in a game as fast-paced as, say, Nuclear Throne or Super Smash Bros. Melee, the little interactions make up a large portion of the experience. Nuclear Throne specifically has a slider for specifically both of these effects. I keep these at around the middle, as I don't want to get nauseous, and I understand everything in moderation, though it is very cool. There is a fight not just for survival, but of resources, similar to games like Doom Eternal and Ultra Kill, in that it requires the player to incur risk to succeed, facing the danger itself for more ammo and health. Nuclear Throne's scaling is incredibly well-tuned in that it's able to convey a feeling of walking calamity no matter what step of the run. The counterweight is the statically heavy enemy damage, rapidly filling and emptying ammo and health pools, and density of enemies and their projectiles rivaling shoot-em-ups. That dance of resources is always lively and exciting. It's a fragile balance between that player empowerment and the difficulty of the game. In other games, I've found this scale as volatile as nuclear elements or atoms, sometimes trivializing the game, and at certain times trivialize it so early that I might just end the run there, because there's no more challenge after that. Other times it can be extremely arduous and painstaking the entire time, because aspects of luck that come with the genre, it never feels satisfying to play. Of course, for the latter, leaning into this facing of insurmountable odds and invoking victory against that is its own gameplay device, and for the former, it is a sight seeing complex item synergy systems and numbers work and go up and blow up things. It's just that I am incredibly impressed at Nuclear Throne's accomplishment at maintaining both urgency and danger in its gameplay. Playing Nuclear Throne reminds me of driving a rally car, going 90 miles per hour through forest trails, shredding twig and bush alike, eternally scared of a single tree stump or rock capable of total annihilation. You can go slow, but you can also just go fast. I did grow up with arcades, not the height of them though, but the digression. Nonetheless, I always left racing cabinets unsatisfied. Growing up, I was never at them frequently enough to get good at them. And when I was simply playing for enjoyment, there was always that underlying pressure of the other arcade patrons waiting their turn. Earlier this year was Genesis 8, a Smash tournament, where I placed 33rd in Guilty Gear Strive and 385th in Melee. These two games are not racing games, but they are, through their origins and gameplay, ways that have shown me how to enjoy and appreciate arcade culture somehow. There was an arcade area at the venue, where I spent multiple hours at the initial D cabinet, and as there were no coins to be inserted, I was having fun being selfish staying there for so long. I was able to delve deeper into the crafted models of Subarus and Corollas in the game, focus in on the pedals, bucket shape of the chair and wheel. I was able to see past the software on the screen and come to notice the other parts of the design meant to complement it. My usual driving setup at home is just placing my wheel on my lap and pedals under my feet. I mean, the lap one is atrocious, but where else would I put my pedals? I understand the tales of mystical DDR or Third Strike Masters that roamed the arcades.
I always felt ostracized inside arcades.
As if I were looking at a toy in a museum, less to be enjoyed, but more to be observed. I've been in arcades in the Philippines and Japan, where arcades are still thriving,
and alongside the more used definition of the word tourist, how I felt in both those countries and in those arcades.
And in those arcades, this feeling that I've surmised to be adjacent to, say, imposter syndrome, I've had for long enough that I'm aware of it being a common symptom of being an immigrant child. I could enjoy the vacations to the Philippines that my parents would bring me on, but there used to be a lingering feeling of presumption. A notable portion of my memories visiting the Philippines is being in cars or tricycles, because often than not I would still be playing video games. When I was younger, it may have been a Nintendo DSi or Sony PlayStation Portable, or on my last trip, it would be on my Nintendo Switch. But those landscapes beyond the car windows yielded before yet another set of glass of my current gaming handheld. Last time I was there, I played through the first three Phoenix Wright games. And even the times I would step out of that glass box, oblivious to the world I would be to either enjoy or appreciate where my parents had taken me. Most of my happiness at that age came from it just being summer vacation. To my much younger self, it was merely another place for me. The beaches of the Philippines no different from the beaches 30 minutes from my home in America, or at least that's how I remember them. The city that I lived in, and currently live in, is filled with Filipinos, so my perception of the people around me in the Philippines was no different from normal. I may have been paraded as the American child next to my completely Filipino cousins, but besides some embarrassment or discomfort, there were no bad feelings. I would go as far to say that there were almost no feelings at all. I might have been experiencing the country and the people, but it wasn't producing any significant reaction from me. After growing up a bit, I've come to look back and greatly appreciate my parents taking me. I only now realize how actually expensive it is to travel halfway around the globe. I don't see it as a vacation where they are taking me somewhere nice, but them taking me to their home, where they grew up and became the people they are. As I become more conscious and lucid, I enjoy a deeper understanding of why they kept coming back. Even like an arcade in the current day, it wasn't the same as it was before, but it kept its soul and its meaning to the people it mattered to. And those trips helped me understand that. Though I see them as trips now, it might still be vacations for my parents. Not as a vacation away from our life in America, but maybe a vacation from the life away from their home. A time for them to rest and shortly revert to the people they were ever so long ago. Maybe they miss those people. I have lived with one of my grandmas. I have been in company with another, and the same with a grandpa. The other died before I was born. The nanai, which I called both my grandmothers, I lived with for the first 12 years of my life. She would be the first face I would see whenever I got home from elementary school. The elementary school I went up to 6th grade. Her chair would be in vision of the door, and she would turn her head to greet me, briefly pausing her enjoyment of Filipino broadcasting, and await for a kiss on the cheek from me. I remember mostly her faith, her chair in the shower. I remember her hands. She's from my mom's side. My nanai on my dad's side and my dad's dad would be a staple of our visits to the Philippines. They would most of the time catch up over a meal or just talk in their home. That home I picture in my memory as incredibly wooden. I remember a piano, a dining table with a lazy Susan, and a small coffee table. It's where I learned how to play mancala. The last time I was in the Philippines was in 2019. It was the same trip where I went to Japan for the first and only time, where I played the first three Phoenix Wright games. And it was the last time I saw my nanai from my dad's side. It was the last time I saw any of my grandparents. Our trips to the Philippines had become sparse by then. I came into that house once again, but this time fully knowing that there was a good chance I wouldn't see this person ever again afterwards. Of course I didn't say anything. No one wants to think that dark about family mortality, and I'm not some weird, dark child. But I looked deep. I held her hand tighter this time. I sat closer to her on that couch where we took a picture. I'm used to giving kisses on the cheeks of elders, but for the possibly thousands I have given to my parents and grandparents, this kiss on the cheek was possibly the only one that I gave thought about beforehand. And I still think about it to this day. I'm talking about it now. My father was the only one that went back to the Philippines for her funeral. The same for his father's. My nanai on my mom's side died in 2014. It was my first dose of mortality. I did not cry until I saw her body in the ICU. I had cried before for not getting a Lego set I wanted or from being forced to watch a scary movie, but this time I cried. I was 12 years old. My cousin Nathaniel and I stayed in a waiting room after that visit to the ICU. We were most likely left there to let the other members of the family grieve as well. In that room, we watched Star and German 985 playing Team Fortress 2 on a smartphone, wiping away half-dried tears that was as we tried cheering up, as we knew no other way to deal with this situation. I currently write this in the room where I last saw her alive. I didn't get to see her in the hospital because she was under tight medical watch. I had given her a similar, stronger kiss on the cheek before she was sent to the hospital that day. I moved in afterwards. Her room became mine. It has been mine for 8 years now. I would say that in our stay of this house, there have been only two inhabitants, though my cousin used to sleep here alongside my nanai for a bit. Two cousins, actually. There are only two pictures of real people in my room. There's a magazine, but I don't really count that. The first person is a poster of skateboarder Pablo Ramirez. He died in 2019 because of an accident while skateboarding. The other picture is of me and my nanai, the one whose room I reside in right now. I like to think that what did not rub off onto me through her may have, in growing up here, if any of that is quantifiable. There, I assume an importance of understanding or interacting with arcades and the importance of transitioning the aspects of what made arcades special is a weapon we turn to in the face of entropy. Differently and similarly, my image of the Philippines has not soured as I've grown older. I'd say it has wavered. Chalk it up to a friction of its traditional views and values, its political troubles, or my relationship with my family, but something that always helps me see past that and still be aware of its beautiful people, lands, and love is the memory of those vacations in the past. My parents' pride and love for their home country and parents added to my own love and understanding for that country, my parents, their tatais and nanais. It's most likely the same that happened with their parents as well, and even though I may never understand, I appreciate being given a taste of the past, be it something as inconsequential as arcade gameplay or ever so daunting as my family's history. I want to use vastly different games from Nuclear Throne to describe my experience playing Nuclear Throne, as roguelikes I often see are more a game structure where a secondary genre takes front row. It's why I've mentioned several other video games or video game genres so far. I played the original Rogue for the sake of this video. I named my character, picked up some scrolls, killed some snakes and bats, then died to two hobgoblins. I looked at the date on the grave and pondered about any significance of me dying in a video game and seeing the date of my death being 1983, a date before I was even born. 19 years before, in fact. Almost my lifetime before my lifetime began. I made a new character, named it the exact same name, and in my impatience stumbled into the darkness and died to another hobgoblin. Maybe it was one of the same two that killed me before. I did not exact vengeance, as about a minute later the true hobgoblin of my 10 minutes playing Rogue revealed itself. The controls page. There, in my infinite wisdom and limited time, said to myself, I'm good.
I have watched and enjoyed Blade Runner and The Secret Life of Walter Mitty. I do not think I must be required to watch Citizen Kane and Pulp Fiction to like them. I have enjoyed The Way of Kings and The Lies of Locke Lamora. I don't think I shall touch my copy of Wheel of Time just yet. I have slain the beast and have seen my own birth. I have killed Mithrix on Monsoon difficulty. I don't think I have enough time to play the Trails of Cold Steel series before the heat death of the universe. Though this entire dilemma is manufactured in my own head, this copper crown smelted out of several layers of excuse, gilded with trepidation and fear for things I probably would enjoy, many times has my anxiety of the future halted my progression in the present. A short thing about revenge before we get too far away from it. In Nuclear Throne, you are given a similar tombstone as in Rogue, shown what you were killed by, and in a way, how long you lived. Now, showing the enemy that killed you is not that much special, but with how fast you are able to quote-unquote get back into the action, that energy of the later levels is almost not interrupted into the next run, even if it sends you back to the beginning. Binding of Isaac was not my first video game. As fathomly possible as it sounds, I do not remember my first video game. It might have been some flash stick game or a licensed Dora game on a VTech V-Smile video game learning console. I just looked it up. It's called Dora the Explorer Journey to the Purple Planet for the GameCube. I have dreams about this game, of Dora with a spacesuit on walking a green planet. I remember the aliens, their shape and color. It's a warm memory for me, contrasting the usual coldness of space I am usually exposed to now in media. Though two of my favorite games from the past 4 or 5 years, Outer Wilds and Citizen Sleeper, while still having that coldness, brought me back to those warm feelings I attributed space to as a child. I don't remember having a GameCube as a child. It was not Club Penguin, as in not my first game, not Nuclear Throne not being Club Penguin. Which I believe it's not, but it is most possibly my first online multiplayer experience. Several years before I would ever ask my parents for a Wizard 101 gift card from 7-Eleven for the subscription, make a Nexon account to play Dragon Nest, or even before I would ever make a Steam account to play Team Fortress 2. I've played Nuclear Throne cooperatively on 3 separate occasions. The first time, neither of us were good enough to make any meaningful progress, and the other two, it was fun, though it was frustrating thanks to some latency, and the tight controls were lost for such enjoyment. I really miss the Army of Two games. Binding of Isaac was not my first video game. It was not my first indie video game. That would most likely go to 3-pack Limbo Trials HD Explosion Man Xbox 360, of which actually brings me to Xbox Live Arcade. Xbox Live Arcade was a pretty important factor in introducing many classic indie games to bigger audiences, one of which was Super Meat Boy, a game that's similar to eating a juicy steak with a fork and knife. Exactly how it should be eaten. It was partly developed by Edmund McMillen, who would later go on to develop The Binding of Isaac. The thing is, though, Super Meat Boy did not introduce me to The Binding of Isaac, and The Binding of Isaac did not introduce me to Nuclear Throne. The game that introduced me to Binding of Isaac was Dishonored. We'll be right back.
Now, I'm not going to go that deep into Dishonored as a game, as I don't want to get sidetracked too badly. What I wanted to focus in on mostly is its genre. I briefly talked about genres, but the immersive sim that Dishonored is labeled always fascinated me as a term, as it's almost unapologetically arrogant. I mean, all video games are simulations, and a lot of video games are supposed to be immersive. Now, there are exceptions, but the phrase immersive sim does not create exceptions, it clarifies its icons. Immersive sim is connected so strongly to Deus Ex, equally as strong as we connect roguelike to Rogue, but we do not call Prey a Deus Ex-like or a Deus Ex Light, or even a Deus Ex Light-like. Of course, the term roguelike in of itself is full of context sensitivity, but the aspects of roguelikes I see as more defined than immersive sim. Immersive sims are often highly praised for their level design, subtly guiding the player, but still allowing for complete freedom in decision-making and gameplay. Nuclear Throne accomplishes something similar. As its levels close in and become more claustrophobic, its screens are taken more and more up by bullets and projectiles, slowly easing you into the soon bullet hell gameplay of the throne boss and looping. I greatly enjoy the progression into proficiency in using all my tools in Nuclear Throne and games like Dishonored. In Nuclear Throne, there really are only three buttons: shoot, switch weapons, and special. It's obviously widely different to the approach of completion in immersive sims, but in their own ways, they are the tools that the player carves their way to victory. I've talked about this wholly before, but not for the other end of the barrel, the enemies of Nuclear Throne. Each stage on the way to the Nuclear Throne has its own clever tricks of level design and encounter variants complementing it. The opening level, the desert, is built around mostly open areas with some small choke points. The scorpion enemy of the desert has a conal spray, but the interesting part is that they actually tend to back away from you. It makes it so their bright projectiles almost camouflaging into the equally bright sand fill up more of the room, backing themselves into corners or tight spots where you might risk getting face blasted by them. They even start shooting regardless of distance, if they're off-screen or not. Projectiles coming from off-screen is a common theme in Nuclear Throne's enemies. The snipers in the scrapyard start prepping a fast-moving three-shot once you enter their line of sight, and the nuclear guardians of the palace start sending you slow-moving orbs even when you enter the level. It's another way Nuclear Throne keeps up the energy, to add incentive to dive deep into enemy packs and sort of take out the backline. On the other end, all the major areas in Nuclear Throne have an enemy that either patrols or actively moves behind you. It creates an unrelenting, sometimes even suffocating atmosphere, which makes it ever more satisfying when you are able to carve your way to safety. In the case of roguelikes, I'm replaying the game several times, so eventually I start optimizing my path and start cutting corners. Dishonored was my first immersive sim that I played through, though on my multiple replays I have done, I do not utilize most of the kit the game gives you, nor interact with much of the side content anymore. I level up Blink and Agility and speedrun my way through the game. That's how I found Dishonored. Games Done Quick and Awesome Games Done Quick got on my radar in 2014. That year was the first GDQ event to raise over $1 million. I was only 12 at the time, it was 20. I only cared about the video games though, I was quite confused about these Doctors Without Borders. The run that introduced me and made me a fan of speedrunning was Decided Sloth's run of Dishonored. This speedrun got me to download and play through Dishonored, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. The second game is now one of my favorites of all time. The first thing I ever uploaded to YouTube was a speedrun. a 3-minute video where I complete the forest world in Super Meat Boy, published on July 3rd, 2014. I wanted to have something to show in terms of my skill in Nuclear Throne, so I decided to try speedrunning Nuclear Throne for this video. I had the goal set to sit on the throne in under 5 minutes, and I'm happy to say that I was able to do it. I submitted the run to speedruns.com and can now say that I am a speedrunner. Not doing it big at like a GDQ, but just like the people that inspired 12-year-old me so long ago. At least relatively to how old I am now. There was another Dishonored speedrunner adjacent to Decided Sloth named Biznap, who also made YouTube videos about another game, Borderlands 2. Look, guns, they suck, in the real world. In fiction, hey, they're pretty cool. I'd say I treat them the same way people might treat swords and magic in Skyrim, though they are very real things that hurt people. I love Black Lagoon, I like most Call of Duty campaigns, and Borderlands 2 was probably the first game I played that had swears in it. It also has a lot of guns, it's a selling point of the game. Borderlands 2 and Nuclear Throne both have a gun god in them. Borderlands 2 and Skyrim were the first two first-person role-playing games that I played, though I definitely played more Borderlands 2, both on where I first played it, the Xbox 360, and on PC. I've never actually finished Skyrim, though I've owned it on 3 separate consoles. It may have been the awesome face level of humor of Borderlands 2 that I was a larger fan at the time, but I feel like it instilled a sort of general enjoyment of guns into me, though I mostly see it as a healthy one. It goes to show how young I am that I watched John Wick before The Matrix. Also, I watched Matrix 4 before The Matrix, but hey. I would go as far to say that Nuclear Throne actually shares a lot in common with Borderlands 2. The setting, common enemies, and obviously the large array of guns. I would maybe include Mad Max in here as well, but I haven't watched that, though I'd probably like it. Biznap made Binding of Isaac YouTube videos as well. Growing up, I was, and I guess am, the generation that a huge portion of enjoys watching video games rather than playing video games. The first time I ever stayed up past midnight was to watch Tobuscus play through Black Ops 1. It's crazy how time flies, huh? I can't really critique my generation about watching video games instead of playing them. I myself watch more basketball than play it. I must stop myself from lying anymore. I am not sure. It's not that I don't know or know that I'm wrong, it's that I'm not sure. Was Borderlands 2 first what showed me Biznap and that's what led me into Dishonored? Which would extremely later lead me into Prey, which coincidentally has a roguelike game mode. Or was it Michael Jones of Rooster Teeth and the Rage Quit series that got me into indie games through their Super Meat Boy video? I look upon my king, Decided Sloth, and his absence cries to me a monsoon of nothing. I look to his YouTube channel and see myself from 2 years ago commenting, R.I.P. my slime, Sloth. Unbeknownst to this 2-year younger version of myself that soon I would be unraveling my past over a decisive mammal. He was not my slime, but he was my sloth. I do not know. I may be the age of a man, but I am nothing but a boy of meat, and not at all super. The dribbling of the basketball of my memories becomes indistinguishable in the torrent of rain that is everything. Everyone fears losing themselves in the degradation of memory, and I am no different. Like basketballs in rain, time to die. Nuclear Throne, while not being a turn-based, text-based dungeon crawler, does carry some pretty hard death. Besides some alt skins and alt guns, the most prolific carryover from one run of Nuclear Throne to the next is the player's skill and knowledge. Nuclear Throne is the sequel to Outer Wilds, or Outer Wilds is to Nuclear Throne the same way Bioshock Infinite is to Deus Ex. Similar to how I stumble exploring my past, Outer Wilds is a game about stumbling through the past, all for the future. I preface this paragraph because Outer Wilds deserves more than me, it deserves you. It is a magical game, a scary game, it is a warm game, and if you have not played it, it deserves your full attention and time. Outer Wilds is an exploration game. It's a Metroidvania for knowledge. It's an information gathering, almost completely vertical progression video game roguelike. You die, then wake up at the same spot every time, almost every time. I talked earlier of Outer Wilds' warmth, of how it kept my childhood vision of space a bit more warmer than most media. It's a lesson of looking towards before for both mistakes and answers, sometimes mistakes that are answers. It's quite the opposite of the tight responsive controls I taught about Nuclear Throne, but for each its own are reflection of fumbling, falling panic in the grand scheme of not space, but life. As I mentioned before, I awoke to mortality before the coronavirus pandemic, but the timing of the pandemic solidified its foothold in my psyche and partly served to improve my understanding of Outer Wilds. I'm going to be forgotten one day. Well, first I'm going to die, but having spent time with mortality and Outer Wilds, I at least like to think I won't be panicking when that time comes. On the other hand, the pandemic has elongated my days, yet stole the years of these past two, almost three rotations around the sun. I had felt as if, I feel as if I've been drifting in space, knocked off course with no fuel in my metaphorical spaceship. Outer Wilds is about intentionally heading into that unknown void, jetpack fueled by the understanding of the past and lightened by hope. Outer Wilds as well is sort of a post-apocalyptic setting. The horror that wiped out the Nomai had become a simple everyday hazard for the present, no different from Brittle Hollow's self-collapsing into itself, or the tornadoes of Giants Deep. The structures, the words of the Nomai became ruin and ancient text, almost fully returned to nature. The thing you use most in the game is almost presented as your gun, the translator. It's your way of carving yourself through history, the sprawling text of the past, the targets. The enemy of Outer Wilds could be the environment, the nature of the universe of Outer Wilds, what kills you, though I wouldn't say that you are fighting it. You're less fighting the elements, but learning to survive and eventually live alongside it. This is applied to the cactus that punctures your suit and sucks out your air, or being obliterated by the sun in its own death. The reason why we are sent into space is to explore, catalog, and understand the world the Harthians live in. In Nuclear Throne, the characters don't even know if the throne exists. They simply move forward because of tales of its existence. And with the other ending of Nuclear Throne, the first being sitting on the throne, it's about ending the cycle, just like Outer Wilds. There are many pieces of work that I visit on almost a yearly basis, and I unlock a new perspective and view on them because I myself become a new person. And though I can never really revisit Outer Wilds because of its knowledge-based format, I can instead forever revisit it in my memory and maybe think back to here about how it affects me every time I even think about it. A strange thing about the word imagine is its oftentimes fantasy connotation, mostly used for creation similar to dreams, both senses of the word. I think in a way we assume this definition when talking about the future. Though in my eyes, imagination is simply not for weaving words of magic and dragons, it is also for tomorrow, as we can imagine the future and the past, but we can only know the past. We cannot do the same for the future. The only thing guaranteed about the future is that it will happen. Tomorrow can be predicted, but it cannot be known. All we can do about what happens when we are laid to dust, what happens in 14.3 billion years, what happens tomorrow, or even in 22 minutes from now, all we can do about any of that is to ultimately imagine it and either be excited or overwhelmingly scared of the situations we may conjure up. I think Outer Wilds has helped me with that anxiety. If I were to put it in another person's words, and I'm going to paraphrase these words, but Tim Rogers once wrote that the empty room is a clean slate. You can put anything in the empty room. A dream, however, is always grounded in reality. Dreams have, well, not rules, not constructs, not even logic. All they need to keep us from waking up is a sense of the real. Dreams have terrorists, dreams have presidents, hostage situations. Dreams sometimes even have terrorist slash hostage situations involving vampires. Dreams mix the real and the unreal. Dreams mix whatever is in our minds. Do your dreams resolve without fail before you wake up? Mine don't. Tim Rogers is talking about Metal Gear Solid 2 being a postmodern masterpiece in one of my favorite pieces of video game criticism ever, Dreaming in an Empty Room. I bring this all up, of course, as I find Nuclear Throne to be a postmodern masterpiece as well. For the purposes of making this video, I recently did a run of the original Binding of Isaac. It felt akin to riding an old bike that I had grown out of, a bike that kind of scared me now. I consciously bought the Binding of Isaac, a game about a mother killing her own child in the name of Jesus, while I was a pretty prominently Catholic 12-year-old in 2014. Then I proceeded to put 64.2 hours into the game. I suppose 63.2 hours were played between the years of 2014 and 2021, as the 1 hour I put into it today, as in when I'm writing this, two things had happened to me in the game. I had received two back-to-back cards of temperance, cards that spawn blood donation machines that I'd normally never touch. Secondly, when I entered the womb, there were two identical rooms of bloody angels with sound effects, much more haunting than I remember. It kinda made me realize just how soft Rebirth kinda is, but also how much more expansive it is. A lot of my hours in Rebirth is just restarting the beginning until I get a cool, unique first item, because I've played so much Isaac that simple stat changes, no matter how good, have become uninteresting for me. These two events of two events happening, almost akin to hobgoblins. Anyway, Team Fortress 2 YouTuber star with an underscore is who introduced me to Nuclear Throne.
The world is mine, nigga, get back. Don't fuck with my stack. I'll show you the ropes, kid. Show you the ropes.
Those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it would not be a popular quote if it were not true. I do not have a doctorate for infectious disease, though I feel as if I just wrote a history in which Dora the Explorer journey to the Purple Planet was involved. To enjoy Nuclear Throne is to endlessly repeat it until repeated no longer, and I used to really dig crab. Then there was, say, a two-weekish span when I was a teenager where 70% of what I ate was crab. We had hunted it ourselves. Now I prefer lobster. Shrimp kind of grosses me out. I'm a big fan of artists simply putting things they like into their own works. Done well, it makes a work so incredibly personal and to me adds authenticity. I like to compare Nuclear Throne to Fooly Cooly, both in its intentional brevity and density, but also its seemingly random yet enjoyable style. Fooly Cooly does not hide its influences and inspirations, and in that transparency, it becomes a work that influences on its own. I find it not odd at all that Nuclear Throne has gangster rap in its soundtrack, has a song comprised mostly out of its own gun noises, has a gun god that beatboxes alongside other mutant characters that only speak alien trash talk, has a secret Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles level, or has an achievement called Sincere Apologies for killing yourself with a disc gun. I was hesitant at first in talking about Fooly Cooly, as I feel like everything you could say about that show has been said, but I'm pretty confident to say that no one has said Fooly Cooly is like Nuclear Throne. Though Hades is not Nuclear Throne, as you might be led to believe. Supergiant Games is not Gainax, but Gainax is Trigger, and Trigger made a cyberpunk anime I haven't watched, though Supergiant Games made one of my favorite video games of all time, which wasn't exactly cyberpunk, but was closer to Art Nouveau, but not like Bioshock, which was Art Deco, and not an immersive sim. Look, I love Hades. I am literally, contractually obligated to say that. In the first week I started playing Hades, I had several 10-hour sessions on different days over that week playing Hades, and if I didn't disclose that, I'm pretty sure I'd lose my lease on life for being a liar. Hades has a stunningly beautiful art style and a story that made me want to hug my parents, so that might arise the question of why I'm making a Nuclear Throne video and not a Hades video. Hopefully, you can answer that question by yourself by the end of this video, but if you specifically held a gun to my head and forced me to talk about Hades using three separate sandwich metaphors, sorry, I don't want to lose my lease on life. Hades is being given an encompassing, delicious sandwich, but by the time you happily chomp up 50% of it, it splits your life into two. Your life before and after crossing that halfway threshold. And since in this second part of your life, you've only had that sandwich, it's just a normal sandwich. Hades is a deli punch card sandwich rewards program, where the prize after 100 sandwiches is that your mother gets to come home. Hades feels like a sandwich with too much lettuce, which is still an important ingredient, but I think we can all agree that the pie chart of popularity between the three ingredients in a BLT is not the same as the alphabetical property the letters of BLT take up. The highlight of Hades is its characters and story. I found it incredibly endearing following Zagreus as he finds his own place in hell alongside friends and family. The problem is, those friends and that family are also his co-workers, and nobody likes workplace drama, nepotism, and having to interact with any of your coworkers more than you would like. Hades is being told you won't be getting a promotion until you're able to sell 100 lettuce sandwiches. And your mother is calling, about to hand you another L. Do the math, that's 101 L's. You're like Cruella de Vil. Nuclear Throne is a roll of sourdough. Garlic spread, mayo, beefsteak, tomato, bacon, and the whole damn head of lettuce all packed in by your mother. Nuclear Throne, I wouldn't say, is necessarily not as deep as other popular roguelikes, but would describe it as more focused and understanding of what it goes out to achieve. Giving you a gun, then shooting you in the face. I sometimes feel like a fully coolly poser. I only watch the show over quarantine and get the feeling as if I'm some FLCL imposter fan. I started this YouTube channel because of similar idle days. The emptiness of those days lit upon my bed a sort of negative spotlight. The same bed where I watched Talk to Me Galaxy, and look how that turned out. Regardless of my actions during the day, regardless of the journey, the destination became the point. I'm referring to my bed. I watched Talk to Me Galaxy on my bed. I've also rewatched Fooly Cooly on my sister's couch, both trying to get her to watch it and also because I couldn't sleep after a music festival. In normal circumstance, the bed would be where I would temporarily die for the day to dream, to once again start the day. Instead, the cycle eventually optimized itself till I was always dead. I've read about Cotard syndrome, though adjacent feelings have always been a more slow rotting inside, not as I've been shot in the face by a laser cannon, but to put it poetically, as I like doing, more akin to thousands of paper cuts inside of me. Also spilling blood not only onto the organs, but onto the paper knives that form itself the scales of the origami Ouroboros inside me. It's also quite ironic that I only know of Cotard syndrome because of Synecdoche, New York, though I am not brazen enough to compare myself to Philip Seymour Hoffman or Charlie Kaufman. I can instead, in my own useless self-awareness, point out my own half-discovering or cannibalization of myself. Another way that quarantine affected me might have been skateboarding, as well as graduating from high school. Skating and high school were both constants in my life, and COVID-19 put a stop to both. I don't go to high school anymore, and I don't skate that much nowadays. The subway station next to my school was both after-school practice and hangout spot. There were 2 5 stairs, a slanted wall, and a curb. The 5-stair was our small after-school tribe's rite of passage, and I have ollied down it, though the only footage I have is of me bean planting it. I can't really be bothered to try recording it for this video. The point is, I never was able to progress much further past that. The hardest trick I've ever done was a pop shove down the Soma 2 block. I never was able to become a kickflip in grind to kickflip out or anything like that. So the point of that point is that I suck at skateboarding. The extreme sports aspect of it all was lost upon me in natural progression, but COVID-19 definitely put the last nail in the coffin for any motivation. Though I did gravitate to the curb of our little temple more, and I started doing slappies. Slappies are celebrated for being the imitation of vert skating and the grandfather of modern street skating. While being deceivingly easy and simple to understand, are also equally raw, at least in my eyes. As explained in Jeff Grosso's Love Letter to Skateboarding, Curbs Edition, what's the right outside the door of your house? Fucking curbs. Curbs and chaos. Instead of the stokeness that is present within jumping down huge drops or tricky rails, skating became something akin to meditation. I've done yoga, like sauna-level hot yoga, and the same way yoga gets you sweaty and stretched out, the curb, the humble street curb, became my metaphorical yet also literal punching bag for releasing the frustrations and anxieties that built inside me, that do build inside me. Even though I was doing the same exact thing over and over again, sometimes I'd fall, but I definitely never get bored. If it's not apparent, the point I'm trying to make, playing Nuclear Throne gives me the same sensation as ripping a gnarly slappy grind. I feel as if I haven't explored this enough, so before I leave this topic, I want to talk a little bit more about skating. It's a very important topic for me. I feel as if everyone is born a poser. There definitely are people who are born skaters, though for most people, for me at least, I was ordained into the hobby. The people who helped me may have been as well, I do not know. I never really felt like a skateboarder until about 3 years in. With my bad ollies and occasional flip trick, people started calling me a skater nonetheless. I remember buying my first Thrasher hoodie as if I was putting on my dream job's uniform for the first time. I don't wear that hoodie anymore, I gave it to my dad. It always makes me smile seeing him wear it. I often struggle with perceiving things I like as things I like, rather than things I think would be cool to like. It comes from the same place as where I avoid media that I think I would enjoy. Instead, the situation of, if I didn't enjoy this certain thing, I wouldn't be cool. So with time, having these hobbies and experience with these things, I've become more self-confident, and I have disregarded a lot of these feelings, and talking about it here, talking about it now, has definitely helped. I have not lived long, but I have lived long enough that I can perceive change within myself, and in doing so, imagine that I will change further in the future. I like Nuclear Throne because it's like other things I enjoy. I could compare skateboarding to Super Smash Bros. Melee, I could compare it with Dark Souls, maybe even Outer Wilds if I try hard enough. Nuclear Throne, Outer Wilds, and Dark Souls all have campfires or bonfires as an important object, which I think is pretty cool, and of course it's a coincidence, but it's still cool. Melee doesn't have anything similar, but the Thrones' second phase is oddly similar to Final Destination and Fighting Master Hand. And that goes without saying that any game that revisits the character select screen in a narrative sense is cool in my book. The same reasons why I fell in love with these games are the same reasons I fell in love with skateboarding. Please indulge me to talk grandly once more. I might ask you again, but just to make sure. The reason was not landing the skateboard trick. The recovery of every fall, the slam of every failure. I have bled for hours for a skateboard trick that would last for under a second, that even other skateboarders could do easily. The euphoria that comes with success is elevated if it is allowed to be preceded by countless failures. Alongside the tactile nature of skateboarding, the grinding of metal against rock, the skin against gravel, the wood against paint, there lies the rebellious spirit of it all. I have heard skating described as the most unnatural thing a human can do, and that's why it's one of the most human things to do. Taking this wooden children's toy and risking life and limb for both fleeting pain and happiness lends itself to the counterculture of skateboards, skateboarding, and even the human soul, or the pursuit of happiness, or maybe an answer to life. The inherent free will and sentience of human beings creating art, creating value in life beyond our primal faculties. The nature of the human soul I see so radiantly present in skating. We are all born posers of life. We are all ordained into the ideas of dreams, of love, of compassion, determination. We learn and hopefully come to accept the concept of the human soul with no scientific backing. We do these unnatural things because we are not natural beings. We tell ourselves, we hope for ourselves, that we are more, and in that struggle against nature, we find ourselves skateboarders. Falling sandwiches in time, too much lettuce inside us, it falls out. The parchment paper below, inked by our guts, that eats us within on the steps of life, so nuclear that it eventually erodes everything away. I could die skating, though many a times I've felt truly alive was while skating. Nuclear Throne, while killing me so many times, asked me to contemplate my past, contemplate my own literal death, and appreciate my life ever more romantically and optimistically. Hopefully what I've said has done that for you as well. I have never filmed a full video part, though I got my VHS camera because I wanted to. It's where you see all this analog footage from. The closest thing I have to a video part is when I filmed all the slappies I could do. That photo of a hot dog is from when my cousin Nathaniel purchased one from 7-Eleven, then subsequently dropped it outside said 7-Eleven. The rest of the video does not take place there. It takes place outside a mall a couple blocks away, where I've been stopped many times skateboarding. In general, have been stopped by cops and security guards to stop skateboarding. Let's get back to that in a second. In Nuclear Throne, sitting on the Nuclear Throne is an ending, but it's not the true ending of the game. If you die at any point before killing and sitting on the Nuclear Throne, you get the message you did not reach the Nuclear Throne. If you die any time after killing the first phase of the Nuclear Throne, you get the message the struggle continues. As I've mentioned before, the second phase of the Nuclear Throne has a sort of intermission, where the game sends you back to the character select screen, where you are ambushed by the interdimensional police department, which kills every other playable character in the game. The objective now becomes to enter the IDPD headquarters and
kill the IDPD captain. If done, the end screen text is instead, "The struggle is over." Sitting on the throne simply continues a cycle. You become the body that eventually withers to bone and is later on replaced as well, all while larger powers that be, a faceless hate, sit pretty. When talking about this ending, I think Reddit user BookMeNot puts it best. "I like it. It's a fitting end for the game. Every time you die, it always taunts you with that message, the struggle continues. You can never stop them, and nothing can ever be changed about your friends' deaths or your own. You've all died in vain, and the IDPD continue to cleanse the universe." If you can reach the captain and defeat her, there's a different message. The struggle is over. There's nothing else to do. They're gone. Defeated. Sure, your friends may have died, you've been beaten countless times, you're battered up, tired, and all you feel you need is a hug and another story around the campfire. You can't have those things, but what you can have is a feeling of finality, of pride, and more importantly, of safety. Everywhere in the multiverse is saved. There's no more torment, no more genocide. That's how I feel about the ending, at least. Maybe you feel differently. I appreciate their usage of everywhere instead of everyone. I think it subtly changes the meaning a bit. So basically, yeah. Cops suck, and Nuclear Throne is a postmodern masterpiece about sticking it to the man. Okay, maybe it's not as simple as just calling it postmodern. I dare not try to define postmodern for several good reasons, though I do divulge myself fully into its pool for the only good reason, because styles of art are cool to think about, though the closest I have been to understanding styles of art is through learning about contemporary jazz or ballet and dance. I have enough knowledge to dance, but not a good enough memory to remember all the French terms for ballet moves that I used to fly through the mental hoops of these mental gymnastics in connecting all of this to a video game. It's not a AAA video game about the information age, nor the illusion of choice, but Nuclear Throne. Nuclear Throne, under its mountain of guns, presented in beautiful pixel art, airs out meta. It airs out underlying submersive delicacy through a perspective connected to us but far away from us. I personally know no fish that can roll, but look at them go. It does not betray its quote end quote. And these are the biggest quote and quotes I could find. Simple gameplay to illustrate the human spirit, but instead it brings it to a new height only by delivering it through that simple gameplay. I have not played Spec Ops The Line. I have not done many things with my life, if that is not painfully obvious by now. Nor have I played the original Doom. But Nuclear Throne has the loading screen tip, if only we could talk to the monsters. And that means a lot, to me at least. I call Nuclear Throne postmodern, as it can only exist because of the past, but strives to serve such a human, non-human experience.
I can cheat death so many times through playing Nuclear Throne, but eventually I will be caught in the hands of death themselves. This jumbled, tangling organizing of past emotions, past memories, and their connections between each other have wrapped itself around me as a cocoon. Be it for escapism or protection, it is definitely there. It may have been formed before, and I am just now seeing it, or it has been actualized in the making of this video. I flip back and forth on my stance of my own self-awareness of do I know or do I think I know if that chasm or abyss, valley of despair is going to erase me into nothing if or once I fall in. And do I have the discipline or will to follow through on improving on my shortcomings? I can imagine, I can know, I can think as I climb my bookshelf, folder cabinet of summer vacations, roguelikes, or skateboarding. I can also push that mental boulder forward, that solid rock of understanding that, like a snowman, builds upon the land it tramples, the land it forms, and the land it is formed by. All while pecked at by my anxieties and insecurities, at any moment possibly falling all the way down. As I get older, that metaphorical bookshelf gets higher, possibly enough to block out the sun. The elephant ladder's trunk reaching and twirling into nigh infinity. I might eventually stop pushing that boulder. That boulder may grow moss, those papers turn yellow, those bookshelves rot, or this boulder might crush me to smithereens. The crows peck every morsel of muscle off my body, the papers burn in a fiery explosion. All in 1 second of eternity. I will postface because I said I wouldn't preface again, but I hope I have given the people, the things in this video, the correct amount of respect while I have talked about it. Because I at least like to think that I love everything. My mom recently asked me if this is all I'm going to be doing for the rest of my life. I had no answer. I have no answer. The closest thing I have to an answer would be to say no, or if the past 12 years were any indication, then I'm sorry. But she wouldn't like those answers, and I wouldn't like them either. I have made so many absolutions in this video, almost trying to answer that question, to find an absolution, a meaning for all of this. If my stream of consciousness has become an oxbow lake, cursed to either dry up or become still water. I have been sure, unsure, unknowing, because once again, I cannot know my future. Hopefully the memories I have recounted, all the video games I have played besides Nuclear Throne, become rainfall and erode a new path toward the ocean. Hopefully the history dawned upon me about my past and the past of others do not become shadow within darkness. Now that my memory and the memory of me and the memory of others that I carry within myself may disappear one day, they will forever and ever have happened. And I think what my parents wanted by sharing with me their world was to not live forever. It was to share with me the world they best knew, their deep past. The developers of Nuclear Throne have stated that each run of Nuclear Throne is a different universe or version of the tale. We all think about the past, maybe regret decisions, I know I have. And unless some unforeseen, bellowing, swallowing, encompassing event happens in my life, I will most likely continue playing video games, but I believe I'll be a different person each time I play a new video game. I believe I have the capacity for change, and however fruitless it may be, grasping onto the straws of memories that make up this broom might eventually sweep me away onto the cosmic arcade. I think it also helps me tidy up my brain a bit. The origami organs in my body tend to fold themselves into an origami Ouroboros, eating me from the inside. The paper is fragile, so I am careful. I don't want the paper to be stained. I try to be true to myself. My hope in the struggle is unfolding these memories to lay out and understand the map of my brain and to plan out the future. Because all I can do about the future is imagine. Hope, maybe predict if I am not left in the dark, but hope, prepare, and imagine that it will be okay. Instead of heavy is the head that wears the copper crown, mutated be the one that sits to ponder on the nuclear throne. Nuclear throne needs no context, yet its context runs deep. It's an amalgamation, yet also a distillation of video games. It's the past, but it's grown up alongside the present. Its current state is relatively new, but our own bodies are fully replaced every 10 years. It's being punched in the face, it's punching someone else's face. Nuclear Throne is the embodiment of I'm here for a good time, not a long time, and is 100% beatable and loopable right from the beginning. It does not ask you to eat a couple of sandwiches. It asks you to kill cops and rap about guns, two hobgoblins I can definitely vibe with. Nuclear Throne is for playing with sunglasses on, but not covering your eyes because you need to focus. Nuclear Throne speaks not with human noises, but mutant cries. The bottom line is that Nuclear Throne is the slappy grind of video games. Nuclear Throne is a tight-aiming, tight-moving top-down shooter roguelike, laid bare on its nuclear world for all to radiate and mutate within. It's warming up with a dangerously large campfire. It's exploring an unknown, painful and pained world, not knowing the future, but carving forward regardless. It's condensed, fulfilling, fun. Whenever I think about a Nuclear Throne, I can't help but ponder everything else. Thank you for watching.